Do you know how to handle it? So we get some assistance. So we move into the first part, assemblage, which is under the title, How May Museums Make Meaningful Their Relations Between Objects, Experiences, and Decolonial Perspectives, When Conventional Formations of Value Are Challengeable. And we have three presentations, and I will take them one by one. And the format is 20 minutes presentation, and if the speaker keeps to that, we have 10 minutes of questions before we move on to the three. And we have three presentations, so 1.5 hours before there is a coffee break. And as I said, I think it's better we take questions for every speaker and try to move on in time with the project. And first up, Julia Kelly, who is a research associate in the School of Arts at Loughborough University. And the title of her talk is Colonial and Counter-Colonial Display in Surrealism. So,
thank you very much,
because
it's working, fantastic. And thank you very much to the Valens Academy for inviting me, particularly to Alyssa, and thank you very much to Annika and Cora for all of their efforts in organising this event today. I'm just going to put on my, slideshow. Is it at the beginning? Sorry, I can't really see from here. Okay, thank you. I will try to keep within the 20 minutes. I think I've written a half an hour paper, anyway. So I'm going to introduce a sort of historical aspect here, and this is largely a red paper, so apologies for that. The role of the historical surrealist movement in providing a model for cultural relativism and cultural critique has been the subject of debate ever since the 1970s and 80s. The fault lines of descent that run through surrealism and its activities have arguably been highly influential for later 20th century and contemporary theory and artistic practice. An assault on the prevailing colonial assumptions of the period was a significant aspect of this descent. So in this paper, I will address the ways in which surrealist strategies of display and presentation of non-Western objects rubbed up against colonial paradigms, in particular in a dialogue with museum anthropology in the 1920s and 30s. In particular, I'd like to assess certain tropes which can be seen as ways of challenging colonial frameworks and which we might associate with surrealist approaches. First of these, in no particular order, is a technique of juxtaposition, what James Clifford has called a collage effect, perhaps, where things are brought into new relationships. Associated with this is a process of defamiliarization, where an accepted understanding of something is challenged by being made strange. And this might involve decontextualization, for instance. Thirdly, there's a concept of the unassimilable object, resistant to explanation, resolutely other. And finally, the notion of the surrealist disorder of things, to cite Carol Sweeney, which refuses classification and attempts at taxonomy. And these are all ideas which I'd like to bring to bear on presentations of ethnographic material within surrealism. So I'd like to start here with an unidentified photograph published in La Révolution Surréaliste in 1926. This was captioned Ritual Scene New Britain, and it's an image that appears to show part of a display from an anthropological museum with mannequins wearing baning masks. Given that this is shown within a surrealist periodical, however, the photograph cannot be read at face value. It has no proper anthropological caption telling us exactly what it is, and it's placed in the context of a sequence of poems. The display itself that's shown in this photograph is representative of a mode of presentation in anthropological museums in the early 20th century that was arguably becoming defunct at this point. So this slide might try to demonstrate this shift. The modern museums of the period were moving towards a reflection of the functionalist principles underlying the discipline of anthropology, where there'd be an attempt to evoke the relationship between individual artifacts as part of a whole. So, to look at objects with a use placed into relation with more spectacular elements like masks, costumes, or sculptures. If the diorama of the late 19th century, however, had used mannequins to create a rather fake sense of cultural reality, a functionalist display like those at the Musée de l'Homme in the 1930s did away with such obviously artificial props. So in the image I've got there, on the left-hand side, you can see installation from the late 19th century at the Trocadero Museum, where you have the use of mannequins. And then in the 1930s, the mannequins are all taken away, and you have these kind of empty costumes displayed with related artifacts around them. The display shown in the La Révolution Surréaliste then represents the tail end of such dioramas, and its awkward outmodedness may well have been its appeal for the Surrealists in the first place. The placement of this photograph within a Surrealist forum exemplifies some of the processes used in Surrealism in order to question cultural values. Photographic illustrations were used throughout, either without captions or with oblique captions, which prized apart the explanatory relationship between image and accompanying texts and had no rationale. So the new encounters between text and image that could be created were consistent with the Surrealist interest in the principle of juxtaposition, leading to the defamiliarization of each entity. And the ways in which photographs of Pacific artifacts were used is very similar here in the pages of André Breton's novella Nadia of 1928, from which you can see two images here on the left, where they're stripped of any conventional ethnographic meaning to float in a world of mysterious signs evoked by the text. The fact that these objects are also in the personal possession of the narrator is a crucial point here, and one of the captions of these images that you can't read properly from there says, je t'aime, I love you, I love you. Now, this is very relevant for the Surrealist so-called counter-colonial exhibition that was mounted in 1931, which is one of the things I'm going to focus on here, which included Oceanic and African objects from the personal collection of Surrealists, including Breton, Paul Éluard, and Louis Aragon. And it was mounted in Paris to coincide with the Exposition Coloniale in 1931, that year. This exhibition had its roots in the Surrealist anti-colonial stances, as expressed in their publications in the second half of the 1920s. Surrealist writers had responded to an appeal in the journal Clarté in 1925, in a special issue devoted to the Rif War, while a manifesto called La Révolution d'abord et toujours attacked patriotism, European civilization, and expressed its support for the Committee Against the Moroccan War. A general stance against all forms of patriotism informed the Surrealist position, as reflected in Aragon's sign-off Contre la Patrie, Louis Aragon, and Michel Larisse's notorious outbursts during the Saint-Paul Rue banquet in July 1925, Vive l'Allemagne and Vive Abd el Krim, the RIF leader. So against this backdrop, the extensive colonial exhibition mounted in 1931 in Paris can only have aroused the wrath of the Surrealists. Together with a Communist Party activist, André Thirion, the Surrealist Aragon came together to organize a counter-exhibition called The Truth About the Colonies, a collaboration between the Surrealists and the French Communist Party. The counter-exhibition had three main parts, and it was set over two floors. The ground floor and part of the first floor were given over to a political display, while the rest of the first floor focused on the cultural impact of colonialism. And this is what you can see in these two rather grainy photos here. There'll be some better ones a bit later. According to the available accounts of the counter-exhibition, the counter-colonial exhibition, its political sections consisted of a presentation of colonial brutality using posters, slogans, blown-up photographs, and economic tables. The section organized by the Surrealists included a range of objects that had in some cases been refused to the organizers of the official colonial exhibition, divided into three categories: Art Nègre, Océanien, et Peau Rouge. The labels themselves pretty problematic. These objects were not given explanatory labels defining their cultural origins, as an anthropological display might have done, but instead carried captions which in some cases highlighted their destruction. One, for instance, pointed out that similar objects had been burnt by missionaries. One of the parts of this exhibition that survives in documentary photograph published in Le Surréalisme au service de la Révolution, which is what you can see on the screen here, shows a label designating European fetishes. And this was part of the irreverent tone of the exhibition. The Surrealists published two tracts relating to the official colonial exhibition, one called Do Not Visit the Colonial Exhibition, which you can see here on the screen, and the second one called The First Appraisal of the Colonial Exhibition. This slide gives a sense of what this thing, one of these tracts looked like, sort of physically. It was intended to be handed out, kind of distributed to people. And this was a tract which was very critical of colonial exploitation. And the second tract in particular responded to an accidental fire which destroyed part of the Dutch East Indies Pavilion during the colonial exhibition. And the Surrealists kind of expressed their outrage at the fact that the fire had destroyed what in their eyes were priceless artifacts, and so had inadvertently continued the work of missionaries on the ground. The colonial exhibition, as several commentators have pointed out, presented a vision of empire that was largely seamless, with a clear separation between the colonized subjects on display and their colonial organizers and control of the overall spectacle. On the slide here on the left, you can see the front cover of the journal L'Illustration, which shows you a kind of spectacular view of the colonial exhibition, with particularly the fake recreation of Angkor Wat that was one of its centerpieces. The two images here on the right of the Dutch East Indies Pavilion, whose destruction the Surrealists decried, give some sense of the exhibition's well-appointed and orderly displays. These are the images of the displays of the Dutch East Indies Pavilion, complete with diorama displays attesting to an ethnographic truth about geographic locales and contexts. And this image here, you can see there's a sort of overall view of the display inside this pavilion. At the back of it is a diorama, which you can see in the detail on the left-hand side. So we could contrast this form of display with the installation of the Surrealist so-called counter-colonial exhibition. The cultural section of this, which we can see here in this slide, presumably borrowed from the strategies of the more overtly communist section, using political slogans to accompany the works shown, rather than, for example, explanatory labels. So placed in conjunction with Marx's slogan, "Those who oppress others can never be free," statues and masks from Africa and Oceania, and they include Baole masks, a Cuba stool, New Island figures, and so on, could be read as representing the oppressed, while by implication their liberators, in this case their Surrealist owners, achieve a higher moral purpose. And we should note in parenthesis that Breton and Eluard also sold off a large part of their collection of African and Oceanic objects at a sale at the Hotel Drouot in 1931, just at the moment that the colonial exhibition was arousing interest in such artifacts. Now, a very intriguing aspect of the counter-colonial exhibition that is indicated in a couple of little-known photographs that have emerged in the Breton archive involves the inclusion of popular items, let's say, cheap games and children's literature. So a slogan in one photograph, which you can see here, reads, "Knick-knacks and toys prepare for war. Bibelots et jouets prépare la guerre." And it's put alongside various kind of political posters. And this seems to relate to another image, which shows some sort of cheap games that and children's literature here, a book by Alfred Crozier, kind of popularizing author. And here you see a kind of mini shooting range style game called Colonial Massacre, and a figure into whose mouth you should throw small balls. Now, given the Surrealist exaltation of their non-Western examples, these popular and, to our eyes, kind of offensive items seem to function to represent a debased colonial culture. Now, one of the central strategies of the counter-colonial exhibition, as we look on it now, seems to be its sense of sacrilegious cultural hybridity. It may have been the case that parts of the exhibition devoted to cultural problems and to missionary activity were initially intended to be kept separate, but these became interlinked. And one of the quotations in the press at the time describes how the main room, arranged by Tongi and furnished by Eluard and Aragon with fetishes, savage objects, and some of the most stupid religious knick-knacks the Rue Saint-Sulpice has to offer, had a great effect. And Saint-Sulpice was had quite a few of these shops that sold sort of Catholic sort of statuettes and so on for people to buy. The display entitled European Fetishes deliberately turned the tables on French colonial culture, describing the statuettes and charity boxes created and used by missionaries in the same terms that had been used to denigrate non-Western artifacts, i.e. fetishes. Another statement in the press at the time read that these missionaries will undoubtedly not be satisfied until the day they have destroyed the last fetish in the Congo and populated the colony with horrible statues in the taste of Saint-Sulpice. We demand that the objects issued from the skilled hands of sculptors be protected and respected. So this inversion performed by the counter exhibition did, however, still maintain a sense of cultural purity by promoting the protection of works which were under threat, and which in this way were relegated to a fixed past, partaking in what is a little bit like a kind of salvage ethnography. And it's interesting to note that the Surrealist counter-colonial exhibition did not use vitrines, unlike their 1936 exhibition of Surrealist objects at the Galerie Charles Raton. Works were circulated in the same space as the visitor rather than being hermetically sealed away. And this image shows you a couple of adverts for modern vitrines in the early 1930s and the different museums around the world where they've been used, including the Fitzwilliam, the Ashmolean, and the Trocadero Museum. The Surrealist display was also notably unprofessional in tone and appearance, especially when we compare it with the installations at the Trocadero Ethnographic Museum in this period. For instance, the exhibition of the Ancient Arts of the Americas, organized by the Surrealist associate, Georges-Henri Rivière, in 1928, and this is the image you can see on the screen here, where you see a much more orderly kind of display, although I do note there's a sort of chapel under the table, which is quite strange. So I wanted to bring the approach of the counter-colonial exhibition into a dialogue with some of the more anthropologically informed strategies adopted by the Surrealists in about 1930-31 in the so-called dissident Surrealist journal Document. So in answer to the question of what happened to the mannequins, which came up at towards the beginning of this paper, here they are, pictured in the pages of Document, shown in the Trocadero stores, where they have been apparently unceremoniously dumped. And these are a tantalizing couple of images which look a bit like the sort of dismantling of the imperial project. But again, they had no particular explanation in this context. Document was closer than the Surrealists to the developing discipline of anthropology and its institutions in France in this period. And it might have more overlaps, in a sense, with the premises of the official colonial exhibition in this regard. Document brought together writers and artists who had been associated with Surrealism, but also museum ethnographers and anthropologists. This periodical had its own approach to museums and their anthropology. It drew from a wide range of museums internationally for its contents and contributors, but with an emphasis on picking out unusual examples. Hence the idea of documents, artifacts that are isolated, taken out of context in many cases, shown apart from overall displays in order to heighten their strangeness. And this was another technique of defamiliarization, but also a quest to demonstrate cultural diversity, particularly in the rendering of the human form. And I'm just giving a few examples here of artifacts that were kind of chosen from museum collections, plucked out to feature in the pages of this periodical, and also the ways in which they were often photographed against blank backgrounds or dark backgrounds to kind of take them out of that museum context. But the discussions in Document, which are very sort of complex and sophisticated in many cases, also work against the notion of the museum collection. So I just want to show the example here of an article written by Erlen Nordenskjöld, because it's very relevant to this context, then curator of ethnology at the Gothenburg Museum, who contributed an analysis of different means of weighing in the South American cultures he had studied, using a set of scales from the museum as one of his examples, and this is the illustration that you can see there on the left, putting this into a dialogue with simple poles with bundles on each end, which needed to be equally weighted to be carried effectively. Nordenskjöld, in his text, related this to an everyday process. Quote, "A primitive scales, which we all use, is made up of our hands when we compare the weight of two objects by placing one in the left hand and another in the right." And he mentioned that his wife, Olga, had observed similar techniques in South American children when sharing out sugar. The ethnomusicologist André Scheffner, who worked for the Trocadero in Paris in this period, discussed in his contribution to the periodical a range of examples of instruments from the museum's collection. He pointed out the supporting role played to the photograph as a means of recording by the phonograph, the record player, which could capture, quote, "open air instruments, someone striking the air or water with arms or feet." One of the series of illustrations for his article showed a terracotta whistle and a wooden drum, both in the shape of human figures, alongside a small detail of a performance recorded photographically by the ethnographer Marcel Griol. What the latter had called an earth drum, quote, which consists of striking the soil in two holes of different depths. And this is a really tiny little image in the middle there, and it's very hard to see, and it's almost deliberately quite hard to see. It's a sort of piece of documentation that's almost like anti-documentation. These examples worked against the rationale of the Colonial Museum as a repository of things to be displayed, asserting instead the significance of performative gestures which could not easily be recorded and documented, and which resisted being captured and commodified by the museum. A different approach, again, was reflected in the treatment by Griol of an artifact from the Trocadero's collection, a Baulay drum. And I'm showing you here an image of this drum, which is now in the collection of the Musée du Quai Branly in Paris. And this is its kind of official entry in the catalogue with all of the correct and kind of elaborate detail. So this is how this drum is presented in the periodical document by Griol. And Griol picks out a detail of this drum, reducing it to a cropped close-up. His accompanying text lambasted the absurdity of not wanting to see this drum as ethnographically pure because of its inclusion of a depiction of a modern weapon, a man carrying a rifle. And his article went on to talk about instances of what we might now call culturally hybrid objects, and he gives examples of, quote, superb spear irons in the Djibouti market made of fish plates stolen from the Franco-Ethiopian railway, and empty Chianti bottles collected by gala boys destined to decorate the earthenware tops of their houses. It concluded, as you can see in this slide, with a self-doubting statement of ethnography's limits, undermining the basis of both the collection and the display and understanding of such objects. So I want to make some concluding remarks here, thinking about the different strategies of display and presentation of non-Western objects inside and outside the museum we have seen. And the two images here at the end and the kinds of presentation they represent conjure a series of contrasts, direct versus mediated, spectacularization versus sobriety, personal passion versus professional detachment, perhaps. Griol's detail from the Baulay drum and the examples of dematerialized objects from the pages of document all tell of real time, the performative gestures of the moment, and of current and ongoing cultural cross-fertilization, which are living rather than dead, not relegated to a fixed time of the other. If the surrealist counter-colonial exhibition included little games whose debased mimicry of colonial aggression underscored their low value, the oppressed colonial subject in the detail from the Baulay drum becomes the aggressor, turning the Western rifle back on the colonizer. The fault line in anthropology that Griol's brief article expressed, however, did not find an immediate reflection in the practices of the museums with which he was associated. The display strategies of the Trocadero Ethnographic Museum remained largely controlled and didactic in this period, commensurate with the increasing professionalization of anthropology. If the surrealist counter-colonial exhibition had its conceptual flaws, primarily in the assertion of the unassimilable mystery of the objects on show and their need to be protected, it did provide a model for a kind of spontaneous, impermanent display, fueled by enthusiasm and political feeling, with the surrealist's own personal connections to the objects on show underlining its amateur quality in all senses of that term. Unimpeded by the apparatus of the Ethnographic Museum, the smart vitrines, the explanatory texts, the counter-colonial exhibition could raise questions, could provoke and challenge, without expecting any answers. Thank you.
So that means we have 6-7 minutes for questions. Do we have a mic? We have a mic there. So if you want to ask a question, raise your hand and the mic will come running. Yes. So, then I will ask a question. So, this is one example, but how many other examples do you have of this connection between surrealist movement and the ethnographic? Is it like many exhibitions, or is it mainly in the magazines and their work, or did they do more exhibitions of the similar sort?
No, not really. I think you can tell in a sense by the fact that there's quite sort of scant documentary material for this topic, that there isn't a huge amount of this kind of practice going on, or at least not explicitly. And one of the interesting things about that, I suppose, is about how we're rereading some of the kind of historical material in order to point to these kind of little moments where there are little sort of fissures, perhaps. And, you know, the Surrealist Counter-Colonial Exhibition is a moment where the Surrealists, who, you know, were great admirers and collectors of all sorts of ethnographic material, came into contact with a kind of political context, and that work was, you know, those objects were put into that sort of dialogue, creating this sort of moment, which was quite interesting. And similarly, the examples I was using in Documents, again, seem to represent a kind of a sort of coming together of ideas, which then sort of faded away again. You know, the curators and anthropologists who'd taken part in that periodical to write very interesting and very eccentric articles then seem to go back to their museums and just kind of get on with their daily work. So there's a sort of, you know, there's this idea of a sort of moment of turbulence, and then things become a bit quieter again, and people, you know, I'm sort of thinking about that, those sort of concepts of, you know, being more professional, they're sort of going back to doing what they normally do. And obviously, when you have all of that apparatus around you and you have to work in that way, then the possibilities for a kind of moment of critique perhaps are more complicated. I don't know.
A question. Yes.
Hi, thank you so much for that. I thought it was fascinating, and I think the surrealists in general are quite fascinating, but specifically the documentation. And thinking through kind of the use of ethnographic material as a counter-colonial act. So I want to ask a couple of things. One is the terminology of counter-colonial versus anti-colonial. So like, if you can just, I'm not sure, and forgive me for my lack of, you know, knowledge about the surrealists, obviously you have so much more, but they seem to do a lot more, there's a lot of anti-institutional work that they do, right? And there's a lot of anti-state stuff in the avant-garde. So what particularly, the word counter, I think is kind of interesting because it maintains the system. So I'm just curious about the use of that word. And then, wow, it's quite loud. And then, you know, it made me think a lot about Chris Marker's film, right? Statues also die or must die. I'm trying to think of the appropriate sort of transition. And that was very particularly and very specifically an anti-colonial sort of film. So can you talk a bit, I mean, that's a little later, you know, but just thinking about it in relationship to the ethnographic material, if you could talk a bit about that.
Well, obviously, the terminology, the counter-colonial, was a term that the Surrealists were using at the time, or at least some of the accounts of that exhibition by either, well, actually, in fact, most of them were by the sort of communist commentators, used that terminology. So that probably came more explicitly from the sort of political viewpoint, and I think one of the things that happened there was that the Surrealists had a part in an event where they didn't quite use it in the way that the Communist Party imagined, and, you know, it sort of that label has stuck, that it's referred to as the counter-colonial exhibition. But of course, the Surrealist bit about culture was much more ambivalent in terms of that kind of stance, I would say. And yes, does contain within it this whole problem of what to do with the aesthetic. And, you know, they were very wedded to the idea of some kind of aesthetic presentation, and they were absolutely clear that these artifacts should be seen as art. And at the time, you know, in the kind of development of anthropology, that was a really moot point. And actually, it was the point where anthropology was becoming more progressive in not seeing those things as art. So you have this sort of clash of those two positions. And obviously, in the journal Documents, you have something going on where the idea of use and function is very much coming to the fore, and the concept of art, and particularly the commodification of art, is being challenged. So those things are kind of at odds. And I think they absolutely then have a legacy going forward in what happens, particularly in the kind of French conception of some of these issues, because I think the Chris Marker film very much is part of that sort of trajectory of a sort of aesthetic response, which, you know, sort of political aesthetic response, which comes out of these quite particularly, I would say, quite French issues, actually. And it's not dealt like, not dealt with in the same way in other contexts, actually.
Thank you very much. With that, we should move on to the next speaker. Thank you very much, Julia.